welcome to New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show. I'm Dr. Wendy Van Dilla, naturopathic physician and your host. In the studio today with me is Pat Block from Barrio Brinery. It's a small business here in Santa Fe, New Mexico. So welcome on the set, Pat.
Good morning, Wendy. Thank you for having me.
Oh, you bet. And this show is going to be teaching us how we can make some of these wonderful fermented foods in our own kitchen. And please watch the other show talking about the products, and we'll be talking some about your wonderful shop, which is on West Alameda and where Camino Lire intersects, and just down from Casa Solano where the La Montaneta Co-op is. So if you're here in Santa Fe, please stop by and taste some of Pat's wonderful fine fermented products, and we're gonna, so please.
Yeah, please do. We're open every day except Sunday and Monday. We sample everything every day, and we're gonna talk a little about home fermentation today. And anytime people have questions about fermenting at home, come on in and we'll talk you through it. We've helped a lot of people, we've taught a couple of workshops, and we're always happy to help people get into fermenting at home.
Oh, good. So why ferment in the first place?
Sure. Fermenting is a food preservation method that makes for a very safe way of keeping food. It lasts a long time, it tastes great, and it's full of probiotic bacteria, which have a wide array of health benefits. And
absolutely,
it's easy and it's cheap as well.
Yes. And one thing I like to tell people is if they've got bad digestive problems, that they work with me or some other good holistic doctor, and once you can maintain your digestive health, you can transition from doing a supplement of probiotics to maintaining your good bacteria health in your digestion through fermented foods.
Absolutely. And we've had a lot of people come in looking for probiotic foods based on their doctor's advice. As a matter of fact, one of my favorites was we had a father bring his young daughter, she's like 10 or 11 years old, in from Albuquerque and said, you know, she's been having all these digestive problems. Her doctor suggested probiotic foods, and we tasted a bunch of stuff, and her favorite ended up being the sauerkraut.
Oh, great.
And I said, well, now you can tell your friends when they ask you what your dad got you for your birthday, say he gave me sour cabbage for my birthday.
Sour cabbage. Well, I've sent many of my patients down your way to sample and taste, because one thing I love about your products is you've got the spicy for the New Mexican hot chili taste, and then you've got a mildly sweet using good raw honey, and then you've got the plain sauerkraut.
Right, a little something for everybody. And it's also nice to be able to have something locally made. You know, there are other probiotic foods in the market, but they've been trucked in from hither and yon.
Oh, yeah.
So it's nice to have something that's made right in the neighborhood.
Buy locally and eat locally. And let's see your wonderful logo.
Sure.
And you were telling me that you grew up in Santa Fe.
I did, right? Just east of the shop, and the neighborhood just west of the shop was called Barrio La Cañada. Another older neighborhood also to the west of the shop was the Barrio Torreon. And there were a number of neighborhoods in Santa Fe that were called the Barrio this or the Barrio that. And so as we came up with the name, we thought Barrio went well with Brinery, and it really emphasized the local and the neighborhood nature of what we're trying to do.
So barrio is a Spanish word, a local Spanish word for neighborhood.
Exactly.
And then why brinery?
Brinery is just a place where things are brined. In other words, put into a salt brine. And so most everything we make takes a nice long bath in a salt brine, and that's where the fermentation process takes place. The only exception to that is our sauerkraut, and we're going to make a little of that today.
Great.
And we'll talk about why it doesn't go into a salt brine and how we do it, and you'll get to see how we do it.
Well, in the medical world, we call a salt brine a normal saline solution. And that's one of the things that's used in an IV solution.
Sure.
So salty water, I mean, that's, if you believe in evolution, which I do, we crawled out of the ocean and we brought the ocean with us.
Right.
So we have to maintain that salty water in us.
Yeah, like you said, you know, most times the first thing they do when people go into a hospital is they put you on a saline IV to get you rehydrated and make sure you have enough sodium in your system. So while some people are cautious and need to be so with salt, it's also something that you absolutely can't live without.
Well, this is a way of getting a good quality product that's healthful in many ways. That gives you the probiotic, gives you minerals, gets you, including sodium and chloride, which we need in appropriate amounts.
Right, and you know, even though they are salty, they're made in salt. If you look at the nutritional breakdown, you eat a pickle and you'll get 120, 150 milligrams of sodium, less than you would in a drink made with tonic water or in a bowl of chicken noodle soup. So it is salty, it has some salt, but it's not too an excessive amount.
Great. So let's see the picture of the beautiful cabbages, because what you're going to be walking us through is a home recipe for making sauerkraut, starting with cabbage.
You bet. And we use green cabbage just because that's the traditional. A lot of people like to make their sauerkraut with red cabbage, with Napa cabbage. Really, there are as many different variations on sauerkraut as there are people and villages they came from where they made them up. So that's the other cool thing about sauerkraut is there's a multitude of things you can do with it.
So this is kind of the typical green cabbage, but as Pat was saying, there's also red cabbage, there's Napa cabbage, which is used more in Oriental cooking. There's also a lot of the cabbage family, like bok choy, the different choys, the kales are of the cabbage family. So all of those could be used in this recipe.
And yeah, I would just encourage folks to look around. Go out online, look at different recipes, look at different cookbooks, and you'll find something that appeals to you, or probably a lot of some things that appeal to you.
So you start off, and walk us through making sauerkraut at home.
Sure. One of the things, the first thing you do is clean your cabbage. The next thing you do is shred your cabbage. Those are...
Clean it how extensively?
You just wash the outside, and then you take the first couple of outer leaves off, because that's where any of your dirt is going to end up sticking to the cabbage. Once you've peeled back the first layer or two leaves, you're going to be at a nice clean cabbage. The next
thing you're not trying to sterilize it.
No.
You're just trying to clean off...
Dirt, mostly.
Yeah.
Leaves, you know, any kind of foreign matter that's on there, or leaves that have started to wilt a little bit. You want a nice, fresh, crisp cabbage. And even when you wash it, you're not going to get all of the beneficial bacteria off of there. Same with all of our stuff. We give it a nice, thorough scrub, but it doesn't take the bacterial matter that's going to start the whole fermentation process off.
So this is a process where you're encouraging good bacteria
Absolutely.
To grow. So you slice it up, any particular way to slice it up, or just?
You know, there's a lot of different ways. What we do is we quarter it, we take out the core, because that's going to be so hard that it wouldn't be good to eat. And then because we're making 60 to 100 pounds at a time, we use a food processor to shred the cabbage. We just use a 4-millimeter slicing blade. You could do it by hand. And if you're just doing a head of cabbage, it's not going to take that long. It does take a while under any scenario, so that's why we're starting with shredded cabbage here today, just in the interest of time.
Mm-hmm. Is it good to do it thin, not big chunks?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we've all had sauerkraut, and one of the things that that I've experienced at the shop is that a lot of people are convinced they don't like sauerkraut, and it's because the sauerkraut they've had was the stuff that came out of a can that we all had when we were kids.
Yes.
That was mushy and soft and tasted like nothing. Maybe vinegar on a good day. Mm-hmm. And I've had a lot of folks who I say, well, just take a taste.
Just try it.
And they have a taste and they said, oh,
wow.
I guess I do like sauerkraut.
That tastes great.
And so that's been nice. And we talked a little earlier about everything that we make being in a salt brine except for sauerkraut, and here's the reason why. You take, and I'm using gloves to keep everything nice and clean, you take your cabbage and then you just beat the heck out of it for a while.
So at home, should we be gloving up or just wash our hands?
Yeah, I think if you just wash your hands, you're going to be in good shape. You always can glove up. It's a little less messy that way as well. But mm-hmm. if your hands are clean, you're going to be fine. Since we operate under the state health code, gloves are a requirement. So we're going to take the shredded cabbage. We're going to open the noisy container that I should have opened earlier. And we've got salt and caraway seed here. And so we're just going to add that to the cabbage.
So how much salt, how much cabbage?
We use about a half ounce per pound. We do everything by volume at the, or excuse me, by weight at the brinery. And that's one of the reasons you want to use a canning salt instead of a kosher salt, especially if you're doing things by volume. If you're going to add a tablespoon or 2 tablespoons per pound, the smaller grain of canning salt is going to get you to a more consistent measurement if you're doing it by volume, by cups, by teaspoons, by tablespoons. We do everything by weight, so it's a half ounce per pound.
Half ounce of salt
per cabbage.
Okay.
And then it's quite a bit less caraway seed. It's okay. About 8/100ths of an ounce per pound. This is about a little less than a 3-pound head of cabbage. So we have an ounce and a half of salt and about 0.2 ounce of caraway seed. And so the reason we don't use a brine is once you start working on the cabbage, then you can either do it by hand or you will, if you look online, you'll see there are a variety of cabbage mashers.
So this is, all it is shredded cabbage, salt, and caraway seeds.
Right. And I don't know if it's picking it up on the camera or not, but you can see as we start to work it here, it's getting more shiny.
Yes.
And what that is there's liquid
and
coming.
And it's shrinking.
It is shrinking. There's liquid coming out of it. And so your brine for the sauerkraut is going to come from within the cabbage itself. And you don't need to use extra water. At the shop, we do pack it in water, and that's just to keep everything out of the air.
So the salt is pulling the water out of the cabbage, and it's making its own saltwater brine.
Exactly, the salt and the mashing that we're doing here. Now, we talked earlier about fermentation being an anaerobic process. That means it happens in the absence of air.
So it's an anaerobic process.
Right.
So it's kept under the surface of the water, so oxygen can't get to that fermentation process.
Exactly. Fermentation happens without any air around, and when you get air around, you start to get rot, you start to get mold. And so that's why anytime you're pickling anything, whether it's at the shop or at the house, you want to make sure that there's a very distinct separation between the air and whatever you're pickling.
Okay, say that again. It's real important to keep the plant material underneath a layer of water,
exactly.
Of salty water.
You want to keep it out of the air.
Because if not, if you get some stuff poking up, then you get bacteria growing that is dangerous for us.
Well, bacteria, yes, but
or
also
mold.
Yeasts and molds. And those are really the ones of greater concern.
Yeah. And they can ruin the taste of a good fermented product.
They can ruin the taste, and they can do negative things health-wise, too. You don't want to be consuming mold.
So it's shrunk at least by half
right.
by now.
And you can start to see.
And it's real shiny.
That there's moisture in there.
And there's water.
Right. And so you just want to work it for quite a while until you get a good amount of liquid.
Ah.
And the method we're using today uses a mason jar for a fermentation vessel.
And a nice glass, wide mouth.
Right.
Mason jar.
And there are, if you look, in shops or online, there are a lot of different things you can buy.
And
you can spend quite a bit of money on it, or you can go in a decidedly low-tech direction, and that's what we're doing today. And if you like it, then you can invest in some of the other doodads.
And you can get mason jars at hardware stores, grocery stores, health food stores. You can buy them all over the place.
Exactly.
And
right.
They're, especially in the fall, they're very abundant because a lot of gardeners are putting up preserves.
Exactly.
And making
right.
ways. Making things. So this is a pint?
Just
that's
a like
pint?
A jelly jar, I think they
jelly
call
jar.
It. Yeah. And so then you're going to, once you have it nice and
or
moist.
Half pint. I think it's a half pint.
Probably so, yeah. It's pretty small.
So it's a wide, so the key is getting a wide mouth quart and a jelly jar or a, and this is going to fit right down
right.
inside that jar.
And what you're trying to do is get as tight a fit as you can. But you're not going to get a perfectly tight fit. And like we talked about before, you want to have that distinct separation between what you're pickling and the air.
So you pack it down as
much as you
can. So
we're
going to
pack it down as much as we can. And then what we're going to do to create that separation is we're going to take some of the outer leaves that we peeled off earlier, once you've gotten down to the clean part of it, and we're going to put them on top of what we've just shredded.
So you're making
a top. A lid, yeah. Out of the larger leaves. And then once you put your second jar in, and this...
It'll have a little platform to push
exactly.
down on. Exactly. Oh, excellent.
And help you create that separation. And this method I saw online and didn't name it, but it is nicknamed the ghetto airlock because it really doesn't take any fancy equipment. And then when you push it down, you can see the brine there that
we made
earlier.
Oh, yeah.
And so now you've got, and if you want to do a little bit less.
You can see like a foam developing.
Right.
So all it is salt, caraway seeds,
and cabbage.
And because of the salt drawing the moisture out, you'll be getting the layer of brine.
And the salt will continue to draw the moisture out of the cabbage. So even by the time we're done here, you'll see that there's quite a bit more moisture. But that's enough to start, and you can put some weight within your jar.
Like what? What would
you can like use? Some... You know, clean stones if you want. Beans, rice, anything that's heavy. You probably
it just goes right inside the empty
just
jar.
Just go right
on
in there.
Top.
The other thing you can do is go with a little bit less cabbage in each jar. Then you can use a lid on the jar. And that will really constantly keep pressure on it and keep the water, the ferment down and the water up. And if you do that, you want to make sure you let it breathe every once in a while.
So this is open to the air. Is that good?
It's not a problem, yeah. Because if you seal it with too tight a seal, a byproduct of the process is carbon dioxide. You'll start to get pressure building up. So if you do use a lid, you want to come in and burp it at least once a day to release that pressure. Mm-hmm. Or you can put the lid on to where it's not sealed tight.
Mm-hmm.
And so
the gas can
get out
so
of the
would
jar.
You like cover it with cloth or something?
You can, and that would keep any, especially in warmer weather, that would keep any bugs from flying in it, any dust from your house from accumulating in there. So
mm-hmm.
yeah, it doesn't have to be dark, but it should be kept in a cool place. Fermentation ideally happens, you know, above 50 degrees and below 70 degrees. You want it a little bit, if you have a little bit cooler space, it's going to take a little longer to ferment. And what you'll learn is after you do several batches, every batch is a little bit different. And so what you'll want to do is you'll start to see fermentation happening. You'll start to see some bubbles on here. You'll start to...
Well, I'm seeing some bubbling.
I think that's more just foam from mashing it up. I don't think we're actually fermenting yet.
Mm-hmm.
It usually takes a day or two for actual fermentation to start.
And can you smell the fermentation process?
You can. You can start tell that it starts to sour, starts to smell more acidic, almost like
mm-hmm.
a vinegar. We talked mm-hmm. in the last show about it being lactic acid rather than acetic acid, but it's still an acid that's doing the pickling.
And that's good when you start smelling
the
sourness.
Mm-hmm.
And how long is this going to take before it turns into sauerkraut?
It really depends on how sour you like your sauerkraut and how much crispness you like to keep in your cabbage. It's probably
mm-hmm.
going to take, you know, 10 days to 4 weeks, just depending on your preference. In that 10 day to 2 week time frame, you're going to probably want to start opening it up and tasting it to see if it's where you like. And some people prefer it to be a little more mushy, a little more sour.
Mm-hmm.
Others like crispness.
Mm-hmm.
And so it really just depends.
When you open it up to taste it, is it better to use non-metal? Or does it matter?
I don't think it really matters.
Okay.
I think if you have wood utensils, you can use them. And I think that's just our preference at home anyway.
So I've heard that the metal kills off the bacteria and that you don't want to use. That's why you're using glass or ceramic as opposed to using a metal container.
I think it probably depends on the metal. There is a producer in Olympia, Washington. They do all of their fermentation in stainless steel vats, much like a beer maker or a winemaker does.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't seem to have any harmful effects. I think I would be a little more worried about aluminum or some of the other metals
mm-hmm.
out there.
Stainless steel actually gives off heavy metals, too. I've eliminated stainless steel from my kitchen.
Sure.
Because of a guest that was on last year taught me all this. But that's why I prefer your method of using glass.
We use glass because it's not porous and it's not reactive. and it's easy to clean and sanitize. At the shop, when we are in production, you know, we'll test recipes in a stoneware crock or in glass. When we go into production, we use a liner, and it's a disposable liner that we made sure was certified as BPA free, and that way we're starting from an absolutely sanitary place every time.
Good. Yeah, because that's one thing we have to be aware of is the containers and what are they contributing to
right.
our food sources.
Exactly.
And is it nutritious or is it something
imparting
we don't
something
want?
Else? Yeah.
Right.
And so we just want to make sure that we're starting from a clean place and keep it clean throughout the process, and that will help you avoid molds, and that's what you want to stay away from.
So does it need turning or stirring or just leave it alone?
Just let it ferment.
Just leave it alone.
Yeah.
And check it to make sure that that layer of cabbage leaf is keeping the rest of the fermentation
exactly.
products underneath
underwater,
that water.
Yeah.
That's a real key.
And you know, say I have heard, we haven't experienced it because we give our cabbage a good going over, but if you start to see that it's drying out a little, maybe it's been, you know, exceptionally dry in the weather or something, you can mm-hmm. always add a little bit of a weak salt solution. And there are a number of calculators online to where we use a 2.5% salt solution. Like we said, it's half an ounce per pound. There are, if you're making a brine, there mm-hmm. are some calculators online that are easy to find that'll tell you how many ounces or tablespoons to use per quart or per liter of water.
Okay.
And so there's
okay,
just
and then you add the weak saline solution.
Yeah, you can add a little more brine
if
it starts to dry out. We haven't seen it happen yet, and folks I've talked to around here have not reported that, but it's something I've read about happening in some climates. So
this, you're making two products. You're making the sauerkraut and the juice.
Yeah.
And they both have probiotics in them.
They do, yeah.
Good and bacteria.
A lot of people will drink the brine, whether it's the sauerkraut juice or the pickle brine, either as on its own or once they're done with the pickles. The only time we've had a customer come in and say that our product molded, it made us scratch our head. We thought, well, that's really weird. And we talked to her and we said, well, tell us what happened. She said, well, I got home and over the first couple of days I drank all the brine.
Oh.
And then the pickles molded.
Oops.
So we figured that out. We told her to go ahead and eat the pickles first and then enjoy the brine.
And then enjoy the brine. Well, I had the pleasure of spending some time in Hood River, Oregon earlier this year. And they have a number of wonderful health products in their health food stores and even their restaurants and even their bars. And one of them is a bottled pickle juice, sauerkraut juice. And one of the products they make is a beet combination. So it's this, the beet juice is this gorgeous, you know, burgundy color.
Sure. Well, you know, you mentioned bars, and one of the things that you'll see in some places is a bit of a pickle brine as a chaser, a back. And so there is a drink called a pickleback, which is a shot of whiskey with some pickle brine. I think I mentioned that I do some bartending at the opera during the summer, and so I was able to introduce the rest of our bartending crew to a pickleback this summer, and they really enjoyed it. Our spicy escabeche brine is a great
Ooh.
Mix with tequila.
Oh, that would be
a
great pickleback.
with a version of a martini. It's basically like a dirty martini. We used Blanco tequila, dry vermouth, a little bit of escabeche brine, shook it up and served it like a martini. It was delicious.
Mm.
We called it the Calientini.
Oh, that's excellent.
Yeah.
So you can flavor this in very many different ways.
Right.
The traditional way that I guess came from Germany and some of those countries would be with caraway. What's another good thing to pop in?
A lot of people like to put carrots in there, apples.
Mm-hmm.
We made an excellent, what we called a spicy southwestern sauerkraut a while back and published the recipe in a new magazine here in town. We took cabbage, serrano pepper, a little cilantro, and green onion. And that made for a delicious sauerkraut with a nice kick.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that sounds great. So you can combine a fruit and a vegetable.
Yeah.
So the fruit would give it a little bit
of
a natural sweetness.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know a lot of people these days have apples and pears that they're trying to figure out what to do with all those. And how about tomato? Does tomato ferment?
Absolutely. That was the first thing I pickled. We did a pickled in vinegar version first, one year when we had an abundance of green tomatoes when the first freeze came. But you can also ferment tomatoes. There's even recipes for fermented ketchup, fermented salsa. So there's no end to the things you can make to give yourself a nice dose of probiotics and delicious taste.
And if somebody wants to add some of these wonderful fermented foods and don't want to go through the home version, Pat sells us some wonderful pickles, a spicy pickled mixture called escabeche.
Escabeche, yeah.
Escabeche, the traditional sauerkraut, and then also a number of different pickles. Tell us about the different products you got.
Sure, we have a kosher style dill pickle, which is kind of the traditional pickle that everyone's used to, except it's fermented, not pickled in vinegar. We have a half sour pickle, which is big on the East Coast.
What do you mean half sour?
Sure, all of our pickles are sour pickles. A half sour spends less time in the brine, so when it comes out, it still has the brightness and flavor of the original cucumber.
So it's crispy.
So it's crispier. It almost tastes like half pickle, half cucumber. And we've had a lot of people who grew up on the East Coast and grew up on half sours that said, you know, I've been living in New Mexico for 10, 20, 55 years. My customer yesterday said, and I haven't had a good half sour since I moved to New Mexico until now. So it's something that, you know, has to stay pretty fresh. There are jarred versions that you can buy in the store, but I've been told that they are not as good as ours to, you know, I guess pat ourselves on the back a little bit.
Oh, yeah. Plus, so, it's local. We're supporting a local business.
And when it's in season, we've been able to find a few sources of local organic cucumbers at the farmer's market. It's a pretty short window here, but we use it whenever we can. We have the kosher style dill, the half sour, then we make a hot and spicy pickle and a garlic pickle. They all use the same basic set of ingredients. It's the proportions that vary. The garlic pickle naturally has more garlic in it. The hot and spicy, more New Mexico red chili. All of them use New Mexico red chili. Pickling spice usually has chili in it, but it's the red chili flake that's pretty generic, whatever you put on pizza. We wanted it to taste like home, to taste like Santa Fe. Mm-hmm. And so we use New Mexico red chili pods. We start with the whole pod and then break them down to include in our pickling spice.
Excellent. Well, as we've been sitting, it's been getting, the water level has been increasing more and more. So this is on its way to becoming sauerkraut.
Yep.
Well, thank you for showing us a home version of how to make sauerkraut in our own kitchens. And thank you for your store, for those of us who are lucky enough to be close to come in and sample your products and buy them. And I know there's a sandwich shop in town that sells Reubens using your
sauerkraut.
We're in
a few different places. Yeah, there's a new butcher shop and bakery associated with Dr. Fieldgood's restaurant.
Yes.
It's in the same strip mall. They're using our products and selling some.
Yeah.
We sell at the Cheesemongers of Santa Fe shop on Marcy Street.
Oh, yes. That's an excellent
Dual site. Brewing on Rufina uses that in their Reuben and on their Bratwurst. And we're in a couple more restaurants and working on a few others.
Excellent. Well, we've been talking with Pat Block with Barrio Brinery. Please stop by and sample his wonderful products. Make your own sauerkraut at home. You've been watching New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show. Thank you, Harvey and Dottie, for running camera. Thank you, George and Doreen, for being behind the scenes. And please continue watching. Thank you for subscribing if you're watching on YouTube.